In this video, we'll be ranking the original American Harry Potter book covers as part of our series to create the ultimate Harry Potter jacket art tier list. If you didn't know, the Harry Potter books have been translated into more than 80 different languages across the world. Most of these covers do include a full jacket art that goes around the back and on the inside flaps. However, we'll be basing this tier list solely on the cover itself, no more. Also, on the rare chance that some of the original artists actually see these videos, please don't take any offense. This is all in good fun, and of course, the great, wonderful thing about art is how open to interpretation it is. And with that, let's dive in. People of the internet, Retro Raconteur here. If we're meeting for the first time, I'm just a dad who loves games and the stories they tell. We post videos every week here, including old school Harry Potter Let's Plays, Hogwarts Legacy news, and plenty more. If that sounds like a place for you, then make sure to subscribe so you won't miss any of our new videos. I'll be honest with you guys, I originally had 18 different editions prepared, ready to discuss for this video, and I wasn't even halfway through them, looked at my clock, and I had been recording for an hour. So I realized it was going to be way too long for a single video, so I'm gonna break it down and go one by one instead. Now, the benefits of doing it this way is that it gives you guys the chance to vote on which edition you'd like to see me rank next. So let me know in the comments which covers you guys want to see added to the tier list next time. And with that, we're going to jump right into the original American editions of Harry Potter. Full disclosure here, guys, I grew up in the US. These are the books that I remember. These are the books that are sitting on my shelf right now. So it only makes sense that I'm going to be a little bit partial to them. However, I don't love every single one of them. So let's go through one by one and break these down here. As we go through this list, one thing you'll see that I'm a really big fan of is when there's sort of a common theme that all of the covers are kind of able to stick to. And so if I had one critique for the overall covers here, it would be that 5, 6, and 7, so Order of the Phoenix, Half-Blood Prince, and Deathly Hallows, she kind of uses not a completely different art style, but she starts going with this theme where it's sort of one color that dominates the overall cover. I really like that idea. I just wish it kind of carried over for the rest of the series, or that she had started it earlier with the original. All right, so breaking these down one by one though, let's start here with Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. Guys, I gotta give this one an outstanding. I have to start with outstanding right away. The main reason is because this is the book, or this is the cover rather, for me, that really started everything. I read the books long before the movies had even been thought about. I'll never forget picking up the Scholastic book order form. I was in the 7th grade, just mindlessly kind of flipping through, and that cover immediately caught my eye. I read the description, knew that I had to go to the library right then, check out that book, and the rest, as they say, is history. So it was that cover right there that immediately caught my eye. And if you notice, there are several little details in this one that you may not catch right at the beginning. The bottom right corner here, you've got Fluffy, the three-headed dog, a unicorn over behind this pillar as well. And then, of course, the main part right here is Harry flying on his broom, attempting to catch the golden snitch. So that one, for me, gonna go right up there into outstanding. Okay, up next we have Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. Not as big of a fan as this one. Of course, the scene here is depicting the final scene of Chamber of Secrets when Fox comes to Harry's rescue. And you can see that he does have the Sword of Gryffindor there on his side, which to me looks nothing like what we've come to know as the Sword of Gryffindor, or the Sword of Gryffindor that we see in the movies. I'm still going to put this one at exceeds expectations, but honestly, I don't love it nearly as much as I do the first cover. Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. For a lot of people, this is actually their favorite book, but this isn't about the text. This is all about the cover. You'll notice as we go through this, a lot of the covers for Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban actually feature this scene right here. Of course, this iconic scene when Harry and Hermione go back in time to save both Buckbeak and Sirius. Again, this one is so iconic for me, but I'm a little torn, honestly. Like, I love the way that Harry looks. I love the way that Buckbeak looks, but I want a little something more out of this one. So I think I'm going to put it down with exceed expectations. All right, moving on to Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. So this one may be the busiest cover by far. We've got Harry on the front here holding the golden egg, and then you can see the other three champions behind him. Again, though, this one for me, I just don't think I can put it in the outstanding category. It's kind of just okay. I do think it's better than acceptable, so I'm going to go with yet another exceeds expectations. Okay, 5, 6, and 7. Now we've reached the point where the art style starts to shift a bit. So this very clearly is depicting the scene from near the end of the book in the Department of Mysteries. I love the blue tint just to this whole cover right here. But for me, this cover right here, like just looking at that instantly, the word that I think of is mystery. Just the kind of wispiness of the candles there. You can see they're like flying by Harry. You've got the doors behind him there. He does look much older here. I love the text for "and the Order of the Phoenix" up there. I think that's a great job and overall really captures that sort of somber mood of Order of the Phoenix quite well. And for that reason, I've got to go with our second outstanding. Half-Blood Prince, here another one of my favorites. First of all, I just love this illustration of Dumbledore. I think in my mind, this is how I pictured Dumbledore really all throughout the series before the movies came around. And even now when I go back and read the books, I picture a Dumbledore that looks very close to this. Of course, they're here standing over the Pensieve. I love the overall green look as well. Not as much detail. There's not really much extra when you look at this cover right here. I do love the green cover, especially because potions play a huge role in this book. And for whatever reason, green just makes me think of potions. But at the end of the day, there's just not enough here for me to bump that one into the outstanding section. So I'm going to go with yet another exceeds expectations. Deathly Hallows here. This one is a little problematic for me, and I'll explain why. I love the colors. I love the way Harry looks here, but there's one big problem here. This cover right here actually served as a book spoiler for me. I've said this to quite a few Harry Potter fans over the years, and no one has ever said they even realized this, so I don't understand. I can't be the only one who thought of this, but the huge problem with this cover here, and I'm going to spoil book 7 here if you haven't read it or seen the movies, turn away now. I don't know what you're thinking at this point while you're watching this video, but I'm going to spoil book 7 for you. Okay, here we go. Spoilers. So Harry, when he is going to die in the forest, that scene lost so much weight for me because in the back of my mind the whole time I'm thinking, wait a second, this scene on the cover hasn't taken place yet. And because of the fact that I knew it hadn't taken place yet, I knew, okay, he's not going to stay dead. Clearly, he's going to come back. So for me, it really did serve as a huge spoiler. Now, I do like the kind of mirror imagery we have with book 1. In book 1, you've got Harry reaching to catch the golden snitch in his left hand. Here, we have Harry reaching up with his left hand. We know to catch the Elder Wand after he has just said Expelliarmus, Voldemort said Avada Kedavra. Didn't work out so well for him. The Elder Wand's like, yo, you're not my master, and it's going to go over to Harry instead. But if you're just looking at this from the cover, there's nothing about this cover other than it says Deathly Hallows, and I know that's the 7th Harry Potter book. There's nothing that makes me say, oh my goodness, I have to pick up this book right now and read it, as opposed to book 1, Sorcerer's Stone, which just had such a sense of mystery to it, such a sense of wonder of, I really need to read this right now. So for Deathly Hallows, honestly, I'm kind of teetering between acceptable and exceeds expectations. You know what? I think because of the fact that it kind of spoiled the part of the book for me, I'm going to put it down in the acceptable category. So there we have it for the American editions. If I was going to rate them as a group, I would put them firmly in the exceeds expectations category. As a whole, I don't say they would be outstanding. To me, though, they will always be probably number one in my eyes just because they are the books that I grew up with. Let me know how many of these I got right, which ones you think I got wrong. We have plenty of other Harry Potter-related videos here on the channel as well, so feel free to check them out. You should see links on the right side of the video now. As always, thank you all so much for watching. I'll talk to you again soon.